thinking about this.
And after the bulletin was printed, rather than print a new bulletin, I thought I would just say sorry. And we'll do the best we can with the videos, but I think you'll recognize the videos. What is Advent? What does Advent mean? You know, I've always been told, preachers have always told me, Advent means waiting. And it never really made sense to me. It doesn't mean waiting. It doesn't. Advent means, actually, can I get one more cake? Advent means the advent of something new, right? The advent of a new car. The advent of someone coming onto the scene very significant. The advent of an occurrence happening. And while Advent and waiting are a good spiritual practice if we live through the year liturgically, Advent really means the event where God came into the world and it changed forever. Changed forever. I think about Christmas and Advent, and we all love gifts. And this was the ultimate gift for us as Christians, is this gift from God to show us through Jesus Christ who God is, that God is not someone to be feared, that God is someone that loves us, who judges us righteously and justly as worthy of God's love already. I think we try to make Advent and Christmas super sweet, though. And when we do, we miss the point. We love the baby Jesus in the manger. We love the little animals next to Jesus. We love the wise men that come from the east. And it's a wonderful story. I think here's what a lot of what we make the story of Advent about.
You've been dumb before, Charlie Brown, but this time you really did it. I shouldn't have picked this little tree. Everything I do turns into a disaster. I guess I really don't know what Christmas is all about. Isn't there anyone who knows what Christmas is all about?
True, Charlie Brown. I can tell you what Christmas is all about. Lights, please. And there were in the same country shepherds, abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night, and lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them. The glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. He shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God, and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. That's what Christmas is all about, Charlie Brown.
Click next. That's one Christmas. Here's another. And I'll preface this with, I don't know if you knew this, but Americans in particular, we love to get gifts at Christmas and then we love to give them back. I want to say it's something like 54% of gifts are in some way either returned, exchange, or altered. Is this more Christmas and Advent?
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Everywhere you go, take a look in the 5 and 10. Listen once again, with candy canes and silver lanes aglow. that will be on your own front door. A pair of Papillon boots and a pistol that shoots is the wish of Bonnie and Ben. Dolls that will talk and will go for a walk is the hope of Janice and Jen. And Mom and Dad can hardly wait for school to start again.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas everywhere you go.
There's a tree in the Grand Hotel, one in the park as well. The sturdy kind that doesn't mind the snow.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas.
Soon the bells will start, and the thing that will make them ring is the carol that you sing right within your heart.
Which is it? Thing is, it's kind of a little bit of both, isn't it? I mean, I love the Jesus story in the manger and Mary and Joseph being turned away. It's an important part of my Christmas experience. But I also suffer from trying to make things happen my own way, pick my own gift. And if we think of Jesus as a gift, and we only think of Jesus this Advent season and every season, and as we go through this Advent season, as the cute little baby without understanding the cosmic implications of his arrival into the world, then I think we're missing an important part. And it may be the unpleasant part. I know I've ruined Hobby Lobby for a lot of you. I don't want to ruin Christmas, but there's more to the story here. And 54% of all gifts are exchanged or altered. We love to have our gifts our way, the way we like them, don't we? More than a third of Americans return gifts they receive. Christ was a gift, and we love to pick and choose the parts of Christ that we like, don't we? Guilty of it myself. We love to pick and choose what we like. And the other things that we don't particularly like, we either sort of ignore, or we say, you know, I'll wait to get to those parts later. What's my next one? I think about this story, if you remember. The angel Gabriel visits Mary and says, blessed are you, you're going to have a child. She's not married yet. And she takes off and leaves her village. And I get the feeling as I read this story, I see and I hear. Think of your favorite spy novelist. These are two women behind enemy lines carrying something that is temporarily in their possession. Elizabeth, John the Baptist, who will prepare the way for Jesus, and Mary carrying something that is more powerful than any nuclear weapon that has ever been developed or ever will be developed. We will fight wars. We will slaughter millions. Religion, I mean, over what she is carrying. And it's not just the sweet little story that we need to think about. How does God do this? And what can we learn from the way here at the beginning of Advent on the first Sunday about the way God works? Well, first of all, because it is Mary, we have Jesus, the sweet child. When Jesus grows up, he's going to tell the people of his time a lot of things that they don't want to hear. And they're ultimately going to kill him for it. Do we still struggle with these things? Let's talk about the role of women. What's my next slide, Kate? Yeah. Women, if you recall, in those days were property. They were property. They were sort of maybe a little bit higher up the totem pole than a cow or a sheep or something like that. They had no power. Their testimony was not valid at the city gates. They couldn't testify in court. Who does God choose to reveal the message that he is coming into the world? He not only chooses a woman. We think oh, he's going to choose, God will choose a prince or a king. No, he chooses a woman. And if we go through the Gospels, Jesus is constantly choosing women instead of men to reveal the truth. He not only chooses a woman, he chooses a poor woman of no standing, from no family. And not only does he choose a poor woman with no standing, no money, no family, but he chooses one in an occupied territory, a nation in exile, if you will, controlled by the Romans. If you think about some of the other famous women in the Bible, think about Jesus' mother in John, in the book of John. Jesus says, "Woman, it is not my time to start my ministry." And what does she say at the wedding in Cana when he turns water into wine? She says, "Just do what he tells you." And she's responsible for kicking off Jesus' ministry. We think about the woman who was crippled for 18 years that I preached about last weekend. And the men in the synagogue are really upset about it because Jesus does it on the Sabbath. What does he call her? Now, men were called sons of Abraham. Jesus refers to her as a daughter of Abraham and essentially puts women and men on the exact same parity in God's eyes. And he did this 2,000 years ago. Couple more. Who's the first person in the book of John that Jesus says, "I'm the Messiah," before any of his disciples? It's the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman, is the first person that he trusts on the planet to tell that he is the Messiah. Not just a woman, but a Samaritan woman. The woman accused of adultery. Remember that story? So all the men bring her and they're about to stone her to death. And Jesus bends down and starts writing in the sand. And then he says, "Any of you who is not guilty of sin, be the first to cast the stone," or cast the first stone. And he basically says, "You men can," trying to pick my words, "have romantic encounters with anyone you want and as many as you want in a completely consequence-free environment because you're men. And you're about to stone this person to death because she's a woman. And that is not God's way." You see the hypocrisy of what you're doing. And of course, just to wrap this part up, who is entrusted first with the resurrection story? And who actually believes? It is all the women in the four Gospels who were first entrusted with Jesus' being raised from the dead. That was then, this is now, right? No. What year did the Presbyterian Church USA first ordain women? I don't know the exact year, but it was like 1969? We still are trying to give the gift back, aren't we? I was talking with Marta this morning, and she said, "You do realize that the PCUSA said it was okay to ordain women, and no church called a woman to be a pastor for the first 10 years or so. That it was only because the Methodists saw how good women pastors could be that the Presbyterian Church USA finally said, yeah, maybe we ought to give this a try. We're trying to give the gift back. Don't click it, but tell me what's the picture on my next slide, but don't do it. Okay. Trying to give the gift back. Tell you a little story. So when I was a child, Christmas for us was a torturous affair. We had this room that we called the library in our house, and it was sort of a big room, they had a lot of books in it. And that was where we did Christmas. And the big Christmas tree was in there, and for about 2 days before Christmas, the doors to that room were shut. The dining room went into the library, and it had sort of those double doors kind of thing, and it had like these lace curtain kind of things. And so we'd go and we'd peek, but we were not allowed in the room. And our family, our cousins, aunts and uncles would bring their presents, and there would be this massive pile of presents. But we weren't allowed to go in until we had Christmas brunch before. And it was really a pretty darn cruel way to do things to an 8, 9, 10-year-old kid. Well, I remember one Christmas, I desperately wanted
this electric car. It was this battery-powered car. And I looked, I think it was like FAO Schwartz or something like that. It was pretty expensive. But I really wanted this car, and I think you could sort of plug it in and charge it and drive. I was imagining myself driving around in this car. And they also had a fire engine, but I was amazing. I'm never gonna get a fire engine. And then one day before Christmas, this present arrived. And it was like this tall, it was about 8 feet tall and about 6 feet wide. It was so big, wrapping paper, they couldn't wrap it. They couldn't wrap it. So they had to take a giant sheet and put it over it. Of course, I wondered, who could that be for? Well, they opened the doors on Christmas morning, and I dash over, and wouldn't you know what the card says? To Charlie, love Mom and Dad. I thought, oh my God. You just look at the size of it. Well, in my family too, the tradition was we all sat around, and it was, you know, my Uncle Lee was, yeah, I don't know, in his 20s or something. He would pick up a gift and say, you know, to Ann from so-and-so. And we had to sit there and watch Ann open her gift. And everyone went, ooh and ah, and it was, okay, here's another. And it took hours, hours. And we finally, the pile started to get lower and lower, and I'm still looking at that. I'm thinking, you know, the car, that's too big for the car. It's the fire truck. And maybe there's a firehouse that goes with it. And I'm going to park it here next to Dad's car in the garage, and we'll set little things on fire, and I'll come out. Finally, all the gifts were open, and they said, Charlie, the last one is yours. And I went over and I tore off the sheet, and this is what it was. When you're 8 years old, that's horrific to do, isn't it? I mean, that is a terrible, but my family is the weirdest family in the world. We did this kind of stuff to our children. I loved the rest of my gifts, but this one, you know, if I got it now, I love it. Then, I knew not to cry, but I think I just sort of stood there and was like, what is it? Open it up and there's little drawers that come out and you put your underwear here. I loved the rest of my gifts. This one, I wanted to give back. You see the connection I'm making here with Jesus. We don't want all of the gifts of Jesus, do we? We struggle with the gifts of Jesus. But Jesus is coming anyway. Whatever your politics or whatever, I'm a historian, and this quote came into my mind as I was preparing this sermon. With Jesus, you've got to take the whole thing. It's not just the baby. As Richard Nixon said, the whole enchilada. You've got to take the whole enchilada. But Jesus will come. Jesus has come. The Holy Spirit is still here, and Jesus will come again. As we go through Advent, let's think about the wonderful little parts of Jesus in the story that we love, and let's go ahead and struggle with the parts that we struggle with. We have one more cake, yeah.
It started in low, then it started to grow.
Thank you.
this sound wasn't sad. Why? This sound sounded glad. Every who down in Whoville, the tall and the small, was singing without any presents at all. He hadn't stopped Christmas from coming. It came somehow or other. It came just the same. And the Grinch with his Grinch feet ice cold in the snow stood puzzling and puzzling. How could it be so? It came without ribbons. It came without tags. It came without packages, boxes, or bags. He puzzled and puzzled till his puzzle was solved. Then the Grinch thought of something he hadn't before. Maybe Christmas, he thought, doesn't come from a store. Maybe Christmas, perhaps, means a little bit more.
I think I'll let Dr. Seuss wrap us up. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Amen.